It's 5:03. Let's get it going here. Again, Ned Webster, head coach at Cal, with Paul Jepsen, the head coach at Stanford, and fired up to be here talking about the two-man game. It's something that's really evolved over the past 10 years or so, especially since Canadians have really infused themselves into field lacrosse. There's been a hybrid of field and box, and obviously in the indoor game, there's tons of picking and repicking and off-ball movement. And so we're going to share, you know, I'm obviously going to talk offense, and Paul's going to talk defense, and just go through different types of picks. And we'll just teach as we go. And if you guys ever have any questions while I'm talking, Coach Jepsen will monitor the Q&A. So he can interject and say, hey, we got a question about this, that, or the other. Can you back it up to this clip? So don't be afraid to ask a question. So here we go. Let me just share my screen. Whoops. Okay. So just real simple, you know, we're going to start off real simple. Why do we set picks? And there's multiple reasons, one of which is to force a switch. You can see number two here for Syracuse, a guy named Kevin Rice, who's at the time, 6-7 years ago, was their best player. Kevin Donahue, he's a crease guy that really couldn't even run by a shorty. So basically what they did was just set a pick to force a switch right here. And I think this Notre Dame defender, as Coach Jepsen will talk about, could get under this and stay with his matchup. But I know that Jerry Byrne, when he was at Notre Dame, switching was not something that he had a problem with. So they go ahead and give Syracuse what they want, and now the best player on Syracuse is against a shorty. Another reason why you might free hands or to set picks is to free hands of the feeder. So watch right here. Number four of Notre Dame is worried about his matchup. This is Stephen O'Hara, Division I Defenseman of the Year, against Kevin Rice, a first or second team All-American. He wants to stay with his matchup. And you can see that he's on a swivel. He sees the pick. If Kevin Rice goes to his right hand, to your left, he wants to get under this. And as you can see, there's not a stick in Kevin Rice's glove right here. And so he's able to keep his hands free for a feed. There's always a time and place for a behind the back, and that was certainly one of them. Where do we set picks? You know, is this an ideal spot? And, you know, it's an X. It's probably a little wide of X. One rule of thumb, guys, when you're setting a pick, you want your back to be facing the area where you want the ball carrier to end up. So number seven has his back, if you agree with me, kind of facing towards the sideline. And we never want the ball carrier to go towards the sideline, unless, of course, he's, you know, dodging towards the middle of the field, towards the opposite sideline. But right here, as you can see, this Notre Dame defender is able to get over the pick. So he's being real rough with the ball. And really, as you can see, the avenue that the ball carrier takes is pretty wide, right? He's actually, since that pick was there, he actually had to go wider than maybe he wanted to go to get to the sweet spot. So we want to set these picks on the near side. And I'm going to explain multiple reasons why we want to do that. The last clip of my portion will show a Duke clip in 2010, which was the first razor pick to ever be set. And we'll get to that later. But you can see the advantages right here. Boom. So right now, by dodging from the corner and setting the pick on this near side, this is called a zipper pick. And the reason it's called a zipper pick is because the hash marks of the football hash marks kind of look like a zipper, don't they? So we set that pick a yard or two just below goal line extended, and we create a really tough avenue for this defender. He's either going to have to go fight over and go over the back of the goal, or get under, in which case he might get hung up. There's contact right there, and the attackman turns the corner. Why do we want to involve the goal? It's basically a seventh offensive player. We are running that defender. Imagine parking a car in the middle of the offensive end. It's a clip from Wayne's World, kids. Tripping up a D guy over the back of the goal is super fun. So involve that seventh man, okay? What's the pick guy going to do, okay? You can see a nice wide base. His stick has got to be vertical. It's got to be straight up and down, or at the very least, it's got to be on a 45-degree angle. You know, it can't be horizontal, parallel with the ground. Really great pick right here. Again, location, technique. And then watch his inside shoulder, his right shoulder. We always want to open up to the ball. We don't want this guy turning his back to the ball because he could get doubled or want to throw it to his teammate. And while his back's turned, he might hit him in the back of the head. So watch his number four opens up to the ball. Okay. And then we want to slip to space. So slipping to space means he's going to slip upfield. He's not going to slip towards the crease because he might get blown up. He wants to slip into open space. So let's say there's contact right here. Coach Jepp will talk when there's contact. We probably want to switch. This shorty seems pretty out to lunch right here. But let's say he did switch and both guys are with the ball. We get this guy slipping into space. Again, by setting the pick here, he only has to slip a few yards, right, before he's already a threat. He's already in shooting position as opposed to at X where it's twice as long, if not further. Opens up to the ball, slips to space. Picks create space off ball. So this is Michael Sowers, best player in the country this year. Super fast, quick, feeder, dodger, good vision. He's taking a bigger, slower defenseman up on the wing, and he gets an up screen by a guy who's covered by a shorty. Again, always want to pick if you have a shorty, force a switch right here. But watch the crowd that this guy draws. He has three guys basically showing or at least committing to stopping him. And now look off ball. It's a 4v3, right? Look at all that space for the black team. Okay. Because they got a pick on ball, this black jersey player and this guy in white, that's two less players off ball, isn't it? So that just makes 22's job feeding so much easier, right? I mean, look at all his options. If this guy had curled a little bit more, he could have had him. This guy at X just snuck back post because his guy was showing real hard. It's just a really good way to create space off ball. Forcing the D to compromise their on-ball positioning, meaning if you set a pick, oftentimes D guys are starting to look over their shoulder, as you can see right here. And, you know, as you're looking over your shoulder, your guy might already be making his move. Okay? It just takes a defender out of his usual game. A down screen, you know, we call this pass down, pick down. Great place to do it on the wings because when you slip, you're already in shooting space right here. If the pick works and there isn't a switch, the midi is getting to the middle of the field. Just a really good opportunity for the offense. Now, let me back it up right quick. We talked earlier, one of those first clips, about your back facing the area that you want the ball carrier to end up. This guy's back is faced towards the middle of the field. That's exactly what we want. But in order for him to do that, he had to go in to the middle of the field and out. Okay? If he had just run in a straight line, the defender would have seen him in his periphery, gotten under, gotten over. So we've got to go in and then out to set this pick. Just as an attackman would front swing his guy to goal line and then set his pick behind. Both D guys go with him. And this is just a sweet, sweet play right here. This might have been the game plan. This guy with the ball is a guy named Zed Williams. This was like 3 or 4 years ago. He was their best offensive player at the time. The D wants to wheel into this, and they don't. You'll see number 20 all ticked off after this goal. But look at this. He opened up to the ball, as we talked about before. Never took his eye off the ball carrier. You just back this up real quick. watch this entire sequence. It's only a few picks, but watch the D switch on everything. They just switched. They switch again. So it's almost like these three guys in red are zoned up. You know, I'm going to play here, you play there. So if the D keeps switching, a rule offensively for us is if they're going to switch, we're going to slip. Okay. If they're going to stay with their matchup, you know, we talked about number four, Stephen O'Hara from Notre Dame earlier against Kevin Rice, the little number two for Syracuse. If they want that matchup, they want to stay with it, then we're going to stick that pick. So we're not going to slip. We're going to stick it and run our guy into that pick. Okay. But right here, you can see the switching. And this is what we call a camouflage pick. So instead of this guy coming and setting this pick on this side, where again, this guy just says switch, 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 switch. He does what we call a camouflage pick, where he just comes around to the other side. See it again. There was a switch. Here's a switch. And watch the counter step. This is another point. Watch number 31 carry to his left to allow the pick man to set the pick. It's very important, because if he had just stood there, the guy in red probably could have just gotten over it. Just excellent stuff. And one more look at it. Again, camouflage pick. Set it on the opposite side. So you're hearing pick right. Again, this is kind of a camouflage pick. Ryan Conrad, best middie in the country last year, two-way middie that is, covered by a shorty, setting a pick on Matt Moore from Virginia, who's one of the best Dodgers in the country. Number 12's probably gone. Pick right, pick right, pick right. So, whoop, he sets it on the other side. Forces a switch, and he allows his guy to get his hands free.
Hey, Coach.
Yes, sir.
So, you know, I'm watching these camouflage picks, and I can't help but notice that it almost borders on moving picks. They're not moving picks, but it's pretty darn close. And I guess my question is, what is the rule of thumb as to, you know, when you want to get stationary
in relation to the rule is you cannot be in motion. I mean, that's out of the rule book. You cannot be in motion. So, you know, any coach will tell you he'd rather the pick not work than you get called for a moving pick and you lose possession. It's just, when you lose possession on a moving pick, it is deflating, because it's, you know, you start getting on the refs a little bit. Come on, that's kind of soft. He didn't really get an advantage, whatever. It's the rule. So you've just got to make sure that you are set and not in motion. You can't be leaning. Can't stick a leg or a knee out. You know, if it doesn't work perfectly, set another one. And that's what I love about this pick in particular, is that it didn't work, you know, and instead of this guy just passing it over to Miles Jones, who's a beast, he just says, you know what, we got two shorties right here. Let's really make something out of this. I think we got something here. This is a high percentage opportunity. Okay. So when he goes to the other side, I think right here, he starts to slip. And if he had made contact with this guy, it would have been red ball going the other way.
Yeah. I think
that answers your question, but just got to be really, you know, just really make sure you're stationary.
Yeah. I think one thing from the defensive perspective, I'll talk defense in a bit, but the camo pick is the fastest pick there is, right? Yeah. And you know, slow picks, ones that take a long time to develop are in the defense's favor, because it gives the defense more time to communicate. So when you cut down the time that the defense has to communicate, you know, the balance starts to go in the favor of the offense, which, you know, and that's why we say that the camo pick is the fastest pick there is.
And I think another good point right here, fellas, when I talk about setting the pick on the near side. So again, imagining the circle of the crease is a square. We're setting it on this back corner right here. The other reason is when we do set a camo pick, look how tight to the field the ball carrier is when he flies off this pick. I mean, he's inside the hash mark. And anytime you're inside the hash, that's a good opportunity. That's a shot your coach is going to be okay with.
It was a good switch. Two more clips. I think it was the right switch to make.
This is what I like to call a flyby. It's pretty close to being a slip. You know, a flyby is when you get to the point where you know you're not setting a pick and you feel like you can create a little confusion. A lot of times a flyby works if number six right here is a few yards behind. You know, if we back it up just a touch. If six is maybe here, 45 could just take off and catch an over the shoulder and get a little wraparound right here. But you can see, I say vapor trail right there, because watch number six. It's almost like if 45 were a jet, six is the vapor trail. And watch how he almost runs into his own guy. You can kind of, you know, both guys sprinted at the exact same moment, and that's when the D's brains popped. They just went, oh, crap. And the switcher, you know, that's what ends up happening verbally for these D guys. Switcher. You know, it's just gibberish. So the faster we can explode into our move, the less time the D has to communicate. Okay, so 2010, Ron Caputo, the assistant coach, you know, is credited as – he was the offensive coordinator. He's the D coordinator now at Duke. But at this time in 2010, he was the O coordinator. And he set this razor pick, which basically is a term for setting a pick along the goal line. For all the reasons we mentioned about the zipper pick, you're creating a tough avenue for your D guy. He got the idea from watching basketball, where he saw a lot of baseline picks where it was really tough to, you know, hedge off a guy getting underneath for a dunk or a layup, or getting topside and still getting to a really close, dangerous shooting spot. So this is with 20 seconds left in the game, 13-13, Baltimore Ravens Stadium. There's like, I don't even know how many people. It was the only night Final Four game. Now, right here, this is a hang-up situation. This is something we'll work on at another webinar. But you've always got to be unselfish in this situation. Watch all these blue guys just cutting for themselves. And watch every guy in white stay with their man. That means if they're going to stay with their man, you just pick away. Like if eight just seals his own guy, 50 can just circle around to the outside of him. Okay? But watch as there's this hang up. And again, yes, it was a pick. They didn't get what they exactly wanted. But confusion has been created. That's another big benefit of the pick game. And let me watch this again. We'll talk about cutting. Now just focus on number eight, the little guy. Max Quinzani starts his cut one way. Whoop. You always want to start your cut in the opposite direction of where you want to end up. So these, again, are the benefits: forcing mismatches, freeing our hands, creating hazards, the seventh man, that is, making the D think and talk more than they would like, increasing space off ball, all good benefits. Okay. Now, again, Coach Jett will be talking defensively, obviously, but any questions as of right now? Can always wait till the end. All right, cool. I'll be monitoring the Q&A, so don't be afraid. All right, Coach Jeff D.
All right. So before we jump into this, you know, I'd like to say that picks are probably one of the most difficult things to defend against in lacrosse. So in order to defend against them effectively, you need to practice the situations a lot. At Stanford, we practice every day while the offense is down shooting. The defense works on pick game, you know, not for the whole segment, but for, you know, at least 5-10 minutes. So it takes a lot of practice to get good at defending the picks. And the defense, and middies included, especially middies, need to be on the same page. So I'm going to give you some rules to think about. But if you're not all on the same page with a lot of these rules, it's going to be really tough to to defend effectively, right? And now some of them are non-negotiables, right? Like communication. Every team should have that as a cornerstone of their pick defense. But the others, you know, maybe that's not a part of your team's set of rules, but this is just to give you some things to think about and help you out with defending against picks. So we'll start with rules for the on-ball defenseman. Right. So the first rule for the on-ball defenseman is guard the ball carrier. Right. That's your number one job. It sounds obvious, but it's really important that he knows that that is his number one job, guarding the ball carrier. And the off-ball defenseman, the pick defenseman, is the quarterback and is doing all the communicating. All right, second rule for the on-ball defenseman is listen for your off-ball defenseman and take quick peeks. You can't peek for too long or your on-ball or your ball carrier will go the other way, right? And adjust based on what you see out of your peripheral vision. And you know, if you hear a pick call, one thing that I like to talk about is taking a step backwards, right? Stepping back will increase your peripheral vision, so you can see where the pick is coming from, and then you can adjust your route to get around the pick. Right, and then when you're through, you can go over or under. We'll talk about that in a second. You scream, "I'm through." All right, and so when I talk about getting under the pick, that's getting around the pick on the cage side of the pick, right? And then when we talk about getting over the pick, we're talking about getting over or getting around the pick on the ball carrier side of the pick. Right, so the getting over the pick will put ball pressure on the ball carrier, but your chances of running into the pick and getting picked off are higher, right? And conversely, getting under the pick gives you a better chance of getting around it, but you leave the hands of the ball carrier free to make a feed. So there's pluses and minuses to both, and we'll talk about how we make that decision. And it really comes down to the off-ball defenseman, right? So the off-ball defenseman is the quarterback. And you see right here, we're looking at this guy, right? He's the quarterback. He is communicating everything that the on-ball defenseman needs to know. He's going to give the direction of the pick. He's going to tell the on-ball defenseman whether it needs to get under or over the pick. Okay. All right, so second rule, your communication needs to be LED, loud, early, and decisive. All right, so by early, I mean, we go back a little bit, you should be starting your communication like right now. One of the biggest mistakes I see from defensemen is they wait until the pick is set to communicate it. As soon as you think someone's going to go set a pick, you should be talking, right? Name, right? Location, pick left, and then get under or over, right? You're judging the vertical distance, the distance between the pick man and the ball carrier, right? And if there's no room there, you're saying, hey, get under. I like to tell my guys when we start off in the fall, let's just get under every pick, because it's easier and it decreases the chances of getting picked off, right? And then as far as where you stand as the off-ball defenseman, you are 2 yards back and 2 yards over. 2 yards back to allow the defenseman to get under the pick, right? And then 2 yards over, in case this defenseman, the on-ball defenseman, runs into the pick, you can switch. All right, and so how loud, we talked about how early you need to be, but how loud do you need to be when you communicate? And I'm going to play this clip with the sound on. See if you can hear it. Webb, you can let me know.
We'll go right back to it here. Connor Fields.
All right, so we go back to that. Right. This guy right here is just so loud. He's loud. He's saying name. He's saying pick left, right? And then once the arm ball gets under, you can hear him saying, I'm good, I'm good. Right? And there's a couple ways to hedge the pick, right? I talked about being 2 yards back and 2 yards over, and we just saw the Maryland defenseman use something called a chip hedge, right? And if you're watching Division I lacrosse these days, you're going to see a lot of teams do this, use this chip hedge where you see you have this off-ball defenseman hedging high to get a whack on the ball carrier, which drives the route of the ball carrier to the sideline and gives this on-ball defenseman more time to get underneath, right? So it's a more advanced technique that's being taught at the higher levels. And just out of curiosity, how many of you out there are learning that chip hedge technique? Just throw it in the chat.
No one. Not yet.
So it's a technique that's, like I said, it's becoming more and more popular, but I would say sticking with the standard hedge is the way to go. Right here, 2 and 2, it's just a good base to start with. And, you know, if you and your teammates and your coach is, you know, if they're teaching the chip hedge, great. But I think if not, it's really tough to start doing that chip hedge in the middle of a game when your teammates don't know you're doing it. So I would say this is sort of the default hedging technique, 2 and 2.
I think it's hard to do that chop hedge too without, like, if I saw on tape a team that was chop hedging like that, I would just slip it every time. Because the on-ball defender would have to respect the slip as that guy was hedging hard, and that would force a switch.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
So you're saying that this number 40, this the guy who's setting the pick, just have him fly.
Right.
Over here.
Yeah. Because 20 wouldn't, you know, he's extending himself from where that pick man would be slipping to, and he wouldn't be able to recover the – you know, the on-ball defender would have to cover him.
Yeah, and I think that's why you can't drift too far out. If you start to drift too far out and try to get a big whack on this guy 2 yards away from 40, right, then he's going to slip and it's going to cause some trouble. But yeah, I definitely agree. I think that the slip is the way to go if you're doing the chip hedge. All right. So switching, it's not our first choice, but it's definitely, it's okay. You know, there's some times when we'll need to switch, especially definitely if the on-ball defenseman runs into the pick, right? And that can happen in fast pick situations, like the camo pick that Coach was talking about, or really fast picks that are set on a GLE. Right, some of your teams may say, let's just switch all picks on the GLE or close to the goal. But I'll give you an example here of a fast pick. We have Duke Loyola, Jordan Wolf with the ball, one of the fastest attackmen around. And you see this off-ball player, Duke attackman, setting a pick when Jordan Wolf is going full speed at the GLE. And it just – it gives no time for number 34 to communicate to Joe Fletcher what's going on. And so it's a really smart switch here because the pick is happening so fast. Coach talked about slips, right? I think one rule of thumb that the off-ball defenseman needs to follow is if your offensive player slips and doesn't set a pick, you have to go with him. We'll see it here. Just throw it in the chat. What would you do in this situation if you're this off-ball defenseman and you see this pick setter start to slip? I hope we're saying go with him.
Cover the pick. I guess he's saying cover the pick man.
Yeah, cover the pick man, right? He ends up not setting a pick. It's like a fake pick and then a really quick slip. So this guy, he's got to go with him.
Yeah. Hunter says move with him because if no one follows, then he's left to score.
Yeah. So midfield picks, we saw this clip last week. This pick is being set, 17 yards away, 18 yards away. And you see how far this Penn State defenseman is hedged off his man, right? That's like 5 yards back and 2 yards over, right? And you can do that. You can have a big hedge if the man setting the pick is not in shooting range. Right. So basically the further away the pick is set from the goal, the bigger your hedge can be. And don't assume your ball carrier is going to use the pick, right? He may deny the pick. And you know, poor guy, he guessed wrong and they got scored on. So I think if we go back to that, one thing that we need to do here is, regardless of a pick or not, when a ball carrier is driving towards X, you need to trail him by a half a step, right? That's in all situations. But especially in a pick situation, if you trail him by a half a step, right, you can react to him denying the pick here or just not using the pick.
If you just back it up a sec, Paul, just another point for offensive guys. If this is why in any offense that I run, if you're being shut off, like I think it was 2007, I was an assistant coach with the San Francisco Dragons when we had an MLL team and Ryan Powell was getting shut off constantly because he was the, you know, leading scorer in the league. And, picking on ball just causes all, you know, for all the reasons we mentioned earlier, but look at number four. So this is Ryan Brown, a shooter, not really a Dodger. That's why he's got a short stick shutting him off. But this is basically like a 300-pound man setting a pick. You know, this is two guys hugging each other. And how hard is it for 32 to get under or over this? So going back to your point, Coach, about being 2 by 2 yards, you can still shut somebody off. But once he goes to set a pick, I think all bets are off right here. You gotta play smart and be a team player. Otherwise, this type of thing can happen.
Yeah, absolutely. The razor pick that Coach talked about is really difficult to defend against, right? Because it essentially poses this conundrum or sets up the defense for a really tough decision. Do I go around this pick or underneath the pick and risk getting hung up or running into the back of the goal? Or do I go over the pick and totally taking away my angle on an attackman who's running downhill and towards, obviously towards the crease and eventually around the crease? So my perspective on razor picks is get under, and I love the chip hedge here if you're taught that. Now, if you're not, then you can stand 2 and 2. But I would definitely say get under this pick, because getting over it just leaves you with a really tough angle. And you'll see Syracuse did a good job of the razor pick in this situation right here, because this on-ball defenseman, he hears pick left, he takes a step back, gets underneath it, and he's good. So I threw a lot out there, and I think for starters, if you're a coach or if you're a player, keep it simple, right? And focus on communicating loudly and early and decisively. Focus on your positioning, 2 and 2. And focus on switching on contact. So communication, positioning, and switching on contact. Right? Those three things should be the base of your pick defense. And then from there, you can start to add in. You add in the chip hedge. You can add in doubles. Add in early switches and things of that nature. But I think keeping a foundation first and then building on top of it is smart. And then we have some picks run here. This is Quinnipiac versus Hartford. They ran, this is back in 2016, they ran a really good two-man game. You see the defenseman there cheating, right? Don't assume he's going to use the pick. Here I think the defenseman can work a little harder to get through this. I think there's plenty of time to get underneath that. And they switch and wind up with a short stick on one of their best players. So here we've got some Maryland Albany clips. All these films are up on YouTube. I think they're the full films, and I think they're broken down into segments in Lax film room. So if we go back to that one, this off-ball defenseman, pick defender, is so far off his guy, because he can be, because his man Connor Fields isn't in a shooting position, right? And he's reading the body language of this on-ball defender, right? And he's just saying, all right, there's no way he's going to get through this pick. And so he switches it, and he actually ends up getting through it. But number 20 makes a really good play of respecting the switch call, right? There's a lot of times where defensemen say switch, and the on-ball defenseman's like, oh, I'm good, I'm going to stay. You got to respect the switch call. If there's a switch, stay with it. Even if you don't think there needs to be a switch. Now, Connor Field, now we have a short stick on Connor Fields. Okay, that's better than nobody on Connor Fields, right?
Coach, do you think that could have been prevented if 20 just wasn't so aggressive on ball and gotten underneath that pick that was so – I mean, it was the edge of the box.
Yeah. I mean, if we go back here, he's really far out.
Yeah.
And if this guy's communicating right now, pick left, get under, yeah. Right, there's plenty of room for him to get underneath. I was surprised this long pole right here didn't slide and get a quick switch.
Yep.
Maryland goes into their invert zone. It's a great bird's eye view at Bird Stadium.
It is. They're high up there.
Really nice show by that defenseman.
I think ultimately a lot of lacrosse comes down to who can, you know, who can win that show. You know, when the defender shows and gets the ball out of the ball carrier's stick, then that's a victory for the D. And if that O guy can throw a fake to the crease to get that show guy to recover and then explode into his re-dodge, that's a victory for the O. It's really about controlling that slide. I know that's off topic from pick game, but
yeah,
I just think so much of offense comes down to that. Like if 40 throws right a fake and, you know, this D guy recovers, he can just explode face underneath, yeah, and have nobody sliding to him except cross creased.
Yeah. And I think, you know, for you young guys out there, defensemen, play around with how much you can get away with when you show, right, in practice. You may get burned. You may realize that, okay, 7 yards is – too much to show off my guy when he's 12 yards out, but maybe I can show 7 yards off of him when he's 15 yards away, right? That's how you learn. You develop the field sense of you know, how much space can I gobble up without the offense making me pay? And then from the offense, play around with stick fakes and trying to manipulate that show defenseman. Mm-hmm. Any questions out there for the pick game? Any picks you want to see again? Or
we have a question from our buddy Zeb Ripple. In a game, would you save the razor pick and use once or twice to catch them off guard, or can you use it over and over? That's from my buddy Max. I mean, a team usually at a defense gets smarter as the game progresses. I think it's why you do want to mix up your sets or your plays, keep them guessing. But something like that, no. I mean, at Cal last year, we ran a big little most of the year and the past 2 years, actually. And it just played to our strengths. We had big shooters up top. We had good dodgers behind to suck the D down close to GLE. And, you know, middies re-dodging into much more space really helped us. So I think it's funny you say that, Max. Would you save it? Because I finally got to the point a few years ago where I was like, if this is the most dangerous play, like if this is the play we want to score a goal on, like 10 seconds left in the game out of the timeout, why are we saving it until 10 seconds left in the game? So we just, you know, we just, you know, went after that play all year, and certain teams defended it different ways. And we just, because it was our bread and butter, we were able to adapt. We were able to see what they were doing and then do something different. So I think you and your coaches need to talk and say, these are our best sets or these are our best plays, and milk them. So good question. It's a great question, Max. Let's see. Chat. You can use the pick a few times to condition the defense and then do something different the next time to catch the D off guard. Exactly. Like not using the pick or a camo pick or slipping the pick. That's why, you know, having a lot of different weapons, you know, in your pick game is so important. You know, to be honest, it's important as a defense to be able to adapt too. Like, we're going to bookend these picks, or we're going to play the picks maybe a little differently. But I think everything that Coach said about the communication, 2x2, and switching on contact, all those rules to me as the Cal coach and the Stanford coach are exactly right. So you D guys, you know, this is a great time. I mean, I know in quarantine, you know, we're going to get back out on the field hopefully soon, but hopefully your parents are cool with you working with a few different players where you can work on the two-man game and say, all right, we're going to work on our slips or our camo picks or, you know, all these different options. This is a great time to get great at the two-man game and great at defending the two-man game.
Yeah, and the last thing I'll add is I mentioned that at Stanford we practice the defensemen practice the two-man game a lot while the offense is shooting. One of the things that allows us to do is the defenders play offense, right? So they have to set the pick. So by the end of the year, the defensemen, and this is true of Cal too, they were learning how to set camo picks and razor picks, and they knew them by name, and they were slipping. And in order to effectively defend against these types of picks, you need to know them inside and out, and you need to set them yourself. It's also fun to do. You know, when you're playing West Jenny and other types of games where defensemen are playing offense, and all of a sudden, you know, you can set a camo pick or a slip. It's just makes the game more fun. So I would definitely encourage all you defensemen out there to learn how to set these offensive picks.
Yeah, and play hoops. I mean, I think that's one thing that we've recognized, you know, recruiting and just coaching in general. Some of the best lacrosse players are also really accomplished basketball players. Because it's so relatable with the pick game and screens and the communication and hedging. And so play pickup hoops. Even if you're like the worst player on your JV basketball team, it's very beneficial, and you're going to be getting sweet shape too. You're going to get in great shape. You might not be as bulky as you'd like for lacrosse season, but man, if you're not going to be sharp with your IQ. So, anything else on your end, Coach?
I think that's it.
Okay.
I think you hit on all the points, and, you know, keep staying active. I know we all want to get it back out there and play, but the best thing we can do is continue to stay in shape. You can do that for sure. And, you know, keep up with this film study. So,
yeah,
our time will come.
What about next week, fellas? What do you want the focus to be on? 1-on-1 D and O, off ball O and D. Feel free to throw it in the chat right now, or email us, whatever you guys are comfortable with. We're psyched to cover anything. Feeding, 1-on-1 D. Yep. Steens. What's up, buddy? Ryo. For sure, fellas. Well, yeah, and if you have any other ideas, feel free to just reach out. All right, Coach Jep, great job, buddy.
Thanks, Webb. You too. I think last week, I think some people wanted to talk about riding and clearing. That was a big – I don't know if that's still
– could touch on that.
Hot topic, but yeah.
Might be part of like a transition webinar. We'll figure it out. More good stuff to come, fellas. But, hey, thanks for taking a little time to better yourselves. And we love doing it. And, yeah, again, if you have any ideas, anything going on, we're a resource for you. So feel free to reach out.